My name is Roy Tinker. I'm here to share a brief testimony of the faithfulness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. I am the older son of Richard and Colleen Tinker, who you've met multiple times, and I grew up as a Seventh-day Adventist. I was baptized into the Seventh-day Adventist Church at the age of 10. When I was in junior high, my parents attended a seminar about the Sabbath given by Dale Ratcliffe. In the following weeks, they read two of his books. You've probably heard about them, The Cultic Doctrine of Seventh-day Adventists and Sabbath in Crisis, which has since been renamed Sabbath in Christ. And as they read, they talked constantly about what they were reading and learning. My brother Nathaniel and I listened, especially at the dinner table as these discussions took place. And the two of us became convinced that the doctrines of the Seventh-day Adventist Church are in error when measured by the scriptures, that contrary to their teachings, the Old Covenant Sabbath command, as stated in the Ten Commandments, is not binding on believers in Jesus Christ and not the final test of our salvation, that the investigative judgment, as taught by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, is a false doctrine, and that Ellen White herself was a false teacher and false prophet, and moreover, that we needn't be afraid of her. So together as a family, we left the Seventh-day Adventist Church when I was about in the ninth grade. It was a scary but morally inescapable choice. God's design is that all the believers be together, as it was in the early church. And his command to us regarding unbelievers is, therefore, come out from their midst and be separate. But there is a covenant promise attached to that command. Let me read the passage. This is from 2 Corinthians chapter 6. It says, I will dwell in them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from their midst and be separate, says the Lord, and do not touch what is unclean, and I will welcome you, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. And then Paul writes, therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all defilement of flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. My parents left the SDA church fearing God and choosing to trust him with their livelihood, their friendships, their future, and their two sons. But one of God's promises in that passage, one of his covenant promises to those who trust in him, is to be a father to us. And he proved himself faithful to his promise in the coming months and years. When I trusted Christ, the Lord became a father to me and has continued to be a father to me from the time when I received the gospel and believed in the Lord Jesus Christ until now. He has faithfully provided for all of my needs, both material and spiritual. And I'd like to point to just a couple of ways since then that he's showed himself faithful. In leaving Adventism, I left a community, but the Lord faithfully gave me a new one, and very quickly, actually. He brought me to a youth group through a friend at school, and through the youth pastor's leadership, I learned and feasted on the glorious gospel truth of justification by faith in Christ and who I am in Christ, an adopted son of God without condemnation, having peace with God and no guilt before him through the atonement the Lord Jesus provided on my behalf. The Lord also brought some great Christian brothers and friends into my life. Through mutual accountability and encouragement in the Lord, we saw spiritual growth, increasing holiness in our lives, and victories over sins. That was during my college years, primarily. After college, I became a Bible study leader with the young adult ministry at my church. And through that Bible study, the Lord introduced me, as it were, to the wonderful Christian woman who would become my wife. We are raising three wonderful small children now. In the years following our exit from Adventism, as I'm sure many of you are familiar with, I often struggled with nagging legalistic doubts and fears about sins and shortcomings in my life. I had been raised in part with the law of Moses, and especially with the law of Ellen White, which is 10 times more impossible to keep, perhaps even more. And I would lapse into worrying about even extremely small issues, as if God were carefully watching and measuring with terrible exactitude my every thought, deed, and word. That probably brings up some passages from Ellen White in your minds. And that kind of doctrine produces overactive consciences. My overactive conscience drove me crazy and still tries to sometimes. But the scripture has been incredibly helpful to me. I'll read a couple here. Here's from Galatians 2. For through the law I died to the law, so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me, and the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died needlessly. And this law here, I would add, is not just the law of Moses. It's any system by which we measure our right standing with God, or our behavior, and Christ died to free us from that. And then in John 17, when Jesus prays to the Father, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. And it is not through law or overactive conscience or spinning wheels in my head or any of that stuff that I've grown in holiness, but rather through the word of truth. Our sanctification is God's work. My sanctification is God's work, not my own. And it's through his powerful word. So I would encourage you, stick to the word of God. It is your food. It is your life. And it's been mine. Thank you.
Amen. Well, as we think about sticking to the word of God, thank you for that, Roy. Let me express my appreciation for the opportunity, as always, to open God's word, to think together with you about some of these things that are there. I know it's been a long weekend and a full weekend, and you're hanging on here, but you could be at home watching the presidential debate with the Republicans, so... Bad as my message may be, this is likely still to be better than that option, so bear with me. Let me express appreciation, too, to Richard and Colleen for all of the work they do, not only at this conference and all of the things that are behind it, and together with Dale in the ministry that they have, but for the very real shepherd hearts that they continually show in terms of this is not a job for them. It is an act of love in so many different ways to share what they have come to know of the grace of God and the work of God in their life. So Richard and Colleen, thank you for all of the ways you are a blessing to me and to so many others. And we thank God for you and thank you for your hard work. I'd like you to take your Bibles and turn with me to Matthew chapter 26. And I want you to just stand in the back of the room and watch one of the most significant encounters that we have in the New Testament. You know that this is the night in which Jesus has been betrayed, and he is going to keep on being betrayed. And the first part of that journey is that he is brought to the house, first of all, of Annas, the father of the high priest, or the father-in-law of the high priest, and then to Caiaphas. They will reassemble, the Jewish leaders will, early in the morning to try and keep some kind of connection as they do what they do in trying to get rid of Jesus with Jewish law and Jewish rites. But it begins with this encounter, or at least this is a significant part. You'll find it, the part I would like you to draw your attention to, at verse 57. Then those who'd seized Jesus led him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders had gathered. Peter was following him at a distance as far as the courtyard of the high priest, and going inside, he sat with the guards to see the end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were seeking false testimony against Jesus, that they might put him to death, but they found none, although many false witnesses came forward. The last two came forward and said, "This man said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and to rebuild it in 3 days.'" I think at this point, Caiaphas recognizes this is not going anywhere, and so he steps in. And we read, "And the high priest stood up and said, 'Have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you?' And Jesus remained silent. And the high priest said to him, 'I abjure you, I put you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God.' Jesus said to him, 'You've said so,'" or "the words are yours. 'I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven.' Then the high priest tore his robes and said, 'He's uttered blasphemy. What further witnesses do we need? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your judgment?' They answered, 'He deserves death.' Then they spat in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying, 'Prophesy to us, you Christ. Who is it that struck you?'" The words of Jesus that he uses are striking. They are words taken from Scripture. He puts together two passages of Scripture as he answers them about his identity. "You will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power." Now, much of that is taken from Psalm 110, when the psalmist begins by saying, "The Lord said," or "Yahweh said to my Lord, 'Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies the footstool for your feet.'" And a little bit later in that passage, he will say, "You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." That was a psalm that Jesus had thrown in the faces of the Jewish leaders just a few days before. You say that Messiah is David's son, but why then does David call him Lord? And he quotes Psalm 110. And because for many of you in with an Adventist background, the book of Hebrews is such a critical part of understanding that he is a priest, but not by the old covenant, but by the new covenant, and he's a priest after the order of Melchizedek. You know how critical Psalm 110 is to that. But the other part of the psalm is taken from the book of Daniel, of his statement is taken from the book of Daniel. "From now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." He's claiming divine prerogatives, God himself seating him at his right hand in a position of judge and authority. And just as we'll see in just a few minutes as we turn to Daniel chapter 7, it talks about the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven, in this case, to the Ancient of Days, where he receives a kingdom over all the earth. Jesus doesn't use the word Messiah. He doesn't use the statement that he is the Son of God, as Caiaphas asked him. Instead, he quotes these scriptures, but the response is instantaneous. Caiaphas hears him, and in a theatrical expression of horror, tears his garments, which a high priest was only to do in the presence of blasphemy, and declares, "What else do we need? Let's put him to death." Now, the reason I draw attention to this is that it's rather striking that the presenting case for the Lord Jesus being crucified on the part of the Jewish leaders was that he claimed to be the fulfillment of the book of Daniel. And the book of Daniel pointed to him in some powerful and significant way. So what I want to do is just look at three passages in the book of Daniel that point us in one degree or another to the Lord Jesus. It is striking that, and I think I said this at an early occasion, there's a sense in which we learn directly more about Antichrist in the book of Daniel than we do about Christ. He is the one who's talked about in a central way in chapter 7, that is the Antichrist, the little horn, again in chapter 8 to some degree, with a kind of analogy to Antiochus. He's talked again about being the prince of the people who are going to come and destroy Jerusalem in chapter 9. In chapter 11, he is depicted as, again, Antiochus Epiphanes enhanced in a powerful way. And in contrast to that, we have a strong emphasis on the nature of God's sovereignty, but we are only given small moments when we see something more than that going on. So let's begin by looking at Daniel chapter 2. And Daniel chapter 2 centers around a dream or a vision, not one given to Daniel, but one given to Nebuchadnezzar. And you remember the story. How he has this, he's troubled by it, he won't tell what the dream is, but he demands that his wise men interpret it for him, and they say, that's utterly impossible. And in a rage, he has threatened them with death. Daniel has the courage to go and present himself, first of all, to the chief of the officials, and then to Nebuchadnezzar himself, and in an act of great confidence says, there's a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. And he'll reveal this mystery. So we get in verse 31 to the description of the king's dream, and then it's followed by his interpretation. Let's read the dream, and the dream is, of course, about the great colossus, this immense figure that has so much bothered him. You saw, O king, and behold a great image. This image, mighty and of exceeding brightness, stood before you, and its appearance was frightening. The head of this image was of fine gold, its chest and arms silver, in the middle and thighs bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. As you looked, the stone was cut out by no human hand. And it struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them to pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, the gold, all together were broken in pieces and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floor. And the wind carried them away so that not a trace of them could be found. But the stone that struck the image became a great statue and a great mountain, and filled the earth. Now, I'm not going to try and unravel the details of this. We don't have time for that. Notice, though, how he begins. This was the dream. Now we tell the king its interpretation. You, O king, the king of kings, the greatest of kings, to whom the God of heaven has given the kingdom, the power, the might, and the glory, and into whose hand he has given wherever they dwell, the children of man, the beast of the field, the bird of the heavens, making you rule over them. You are the head of gold. Now, let me just remind you, the great theme of Daniel, with all of its other themes and messages, is in spite of all appearance, God is sovereign in all that happens. And it's never more clear than here. Nebuchadnezzar, the great king who has ravaged Jerusalem, who's ravaged and destroyed so much of the population, who sent away a huge amount or brought a huge amount of them over the course of time. It'll be a little bit later than this particular dream is given, and they will be imprisoned, or at least they will become refugees in the land of Babylon. That Nebuchadnezzar is who he is because God is sovereignly at work. And I need to remind myself over and over of this reality, because it's so easy to lose sight of it. You probably heard news has a way of circulating, but one of the unexpected events happened that Antonin Scalia died today, suddenly in his sleep. Supreme Court justice, known for being the kind of bulwark of the conservatives. And others were thinking of, you know, other ones who weren't there. And now all of a sudden, the whole question of the presidency and will another Supreme Court be a judge with Obama and so forth. And we know how much, and it's easy to think, oh, what's going to happen now? What's going to happen to our country? What if, depending on your politics, but I think I'm fairly, what if the president actually gets this through and we get this wrong in our country? And that I was listening to the beginning of the debate on the way over, and that's what they're saying, that if the wrong person gets elected, this country is going to go to hell in a handbasket. Well, Donald Trump probably put it that way, but it's so easy to forget as we look at things that come unexpectedly, that God is not taken by surprise in these events. And he's sovereign in the affairs of men. And he's sovereign in the Nebuchadnezzars that arise. And then in the next area, the chest and the arms, the powerful Persians who arise. And then when the Greeks arise and stream through the world with their Hellenizing customs, and then the Romans, who will ultimately be the ones at whose hand the city is destroyed again, and Jews are permitted, not permitted, even to live in the city of Jerusalem in 135 AD. And Daniel is talking to one of those kings and saying, you got there only because of God. But there's going to come a time when this powerful colossus of the times of the Gentiles, epitomized by that image, is going to be obliterated. And so, having made all of the details of it clear, notice what is said in verse 44. In the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor shall the kingdom be left to another people. It will break in pieces all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, and it shall stand forever. Just as you saw that a stone was cut from a mountain by no human hand, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has known to the king what shall be after this. That no matter how powerful, imposing Gentile kingdoms come, God has a kingdom, and he will not be defeated in the establishment of that kingdom. Now, you'll notice several things about this. First of all, this stone is a kind of symbol that is used in different ways in the Old Testament. In Deuteronomy chapter 32, in Moses, one of his final declarations, he talks about God, and he uses the title four different times, our rock, his way is perfect. Our rock is not like their rock, referring to the other nations, because our rock is substantial and large. And that image of the rock representing God himself. And then you have some other images, and they're taken not so much out of the kind of rock that they would have seen over and over as they trekked through the wilderness for 40 years. One of the things, if you ever get a chance to travel to Israel again, you will realize they do rocks. I mean, there is rock and stone everywhere. But it was an image of God, and David loved that imagery in the Psalms over and over. But there's the other image of the cornerstone of the building. The stone which the builders had rejected has become the chief cornerstone, as Psalm 119 will say, and that picture will be picked up. So the stone is not simply an image of something random. It has these connotations of what God is doing and what God is building. But this stone, you'll notice, is cut out by no human hands. It is supernatural in its origin, and it's destructive in its effect. Its final result will be to hit the Colossus and shatter it entirely, and the winds will blow away the dust and all that will remain of the great achievements of men. And you begin to think of what Nebuchadnezzar was hearing, was that no matter how great and magnificent his city was, there was a kingdom that was going to crush it, and is going to crush it catastrophically. One commentator describes this passage and says it describes the quiet victory of the gospel. And I look at that and say, no, no, this is not the quiet victory of the gospel. This is the powerful entrance of God in his power into the world to establish his kingdom. And so the kingdom is described also as universal in its scope. The stone grows and becomes a great mountain that fills the earth. It's earthly in its nature, takes exactly the same place that belonged to humanity. It's everlasting in its duration. It's eschatological, that it's at the end of time in terms of its arrival. In all of these ways, Daniel is telling Nebuchadnezzar, through the vision that God has given to Nebuchadnezzar, there is a kingdom coming built around a king. You're the head of gold, but the kingdom, even though the king is not mentioned here, is going to reduce everything that you valued, everything that is significant, to empty ashes and insignificance. He doesn't tell us anything more about the kingdom. But there's a very similar kind of setting forth of the lines of human history in chapter 7. So let's turn there. This occurs when another king has come to the throne, Belshazzar, decades after the first story, but it follows the same kind of pattern. It's a vision, again, of the course of history, only this time it's not a giant colossus. This time it's wild beasts, and especially for Israel, devouring beasts who were going to set their teeth on the nation of Israel and seemingly have every opportunity to destroy it. A lion, a bear, a leopard, one that is so indescribably powerful, and begins to talk about the details of it. But then suddenly in verse 12, our attention is taken in a different direction. I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, I'm sorry, I meant to begin reading down at verse 9, so let's go back down to verse 9. As I looked, thrones were placed, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames, its wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued and came from before him. 1,000,000 served him, and 10,000 times 10,000. There is no higher number in Hebrew than 10,000, or in Aramaic. And so 10,000 times 10,000 is just a way of saying the most immense number you can imagine, stood before him. The court sat in judgment, and the books were open. And of course, this is a depiction of the sovereign God, that towering over, as it were, the empires of men with their beastly ideas and their beastly values and their beastly attitudes was a sovereign God, the Ancient of Days. That term is used to describe him as the Eternal One, the one who has always been. It describes him not as aged and infirm, but aged and fully and powerfully in control, with his clothing white as snow in terms of his holiness, the hair of his head like pure wool in terms of his virility and also his age, and the fire around him in terms of the intensity of his holiness, and the angelic beings in innumerable multitudes bowing down and serving him. And he is calling the court into session for the disposition of the affairs of history. Well, there's a kind of intervening section in it. And then we come to the statement that was on the lips of the Lord Jesus as he stood before Caiaphas and clearly on his heart. I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, there came one like a son of man, and he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him, and to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that will not be destroyed. Now, the description of it is surprising to us, but as you think about this and you think of it in terms of the Gospels, you will see how deeply, and of course it's on one level impossible for us to enter into the inner being of our Lord Jesus. But this was a passage that obviously was deeply ingrained in his heart. One like a son of man. The expression son of man is just a Hebrew or a Aramaic, in this case, way of talking about a human. But he was human-like, one like a son of man. But when we get to the Gospels, we hear this over and over. 81 times in the New Testament, the expression the Son of Man is used. Every time it refers to Jesus and only to Jesus. 79 times he calls himself the Son of Man. 79 times. The interesting thing is, nobody else does. The only two times he doesn't speak that, referring to himself, is once in Luke where he's being quoted, and the other time when the Pharisees challenge and say, who is this Son of Man? The rabbis read this passage and they believed it was a description of Messiah. That's why the reaction from Caiaphas on one sense. But we need, as we read that, to understand what's said. He is like a human. That's what he appears. He sees a human when he sees him. And yet, at the same time, he is heavenly in origin. He doesn't emerge from the earth. He comes with the clouds of heaven. And then we begin to think of how often the clouds are mentioned in the Old Testament. And consistently they are used of that which surrounds the divine presence. To say that he comes with the clouds of heaven is to say that he's heavenly, at the same time in some way mysteriously he is human. He is exalted in character. The angels are bowing before the Ancient of Days, sitting on his throne and speaking as undoubtedly something of Isaiah as they're covering their eyes and shouting, but this one, as the text says, simply comes to the Ancient of Days. And he was presented before him. It's impossible here not to think of Revelation 5. Which clearly picks on some of this imagery. And you remember the chapter 5 of Revelation begins with the one who's seated on the throne, God himself, having in his hand a 7-sealed scroll. And the cry going out, who's worthy to take the scroll and to open the seals? No one is worthy. And John begins to weep. Because that's the title deed to the earth. That's the one who has the right to establish the kingdom of God, and no one's worthy. And then you hear the angel rebuking John and saying, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, he's overcome. He's been victorious. He's worthy. And in that marvelous picture, John sees a lamb bearing the marks of slaughter, going and taking the seal. And in Revelation chapter 6, verse 1, beginning to open the seals to claim the inheritance that is rightfully his. In chapter 24 of Matthew, just a little bit before the passage we read, as he spoke to Caiaphas, he'd spoken to his own men as they oversaw the temple on the Mount of Olives. And Jesus began to talk about the events that were going to surround the future. And he looks at them and he says, then will appear in heaven the sign of the Son of Man. Then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he's thinking of this passage. But then I think of all of those other things he said. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. The Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Jesus saw himself in this passage. He knew himself in this passage. He knew himself by this passage. He is the Messiah who is eternal because his kingdom is an eternal kingdom. It is one, as it says, a dominion is an everlasting dominion that shall not pass away. His kingdom is one that shall not be destroyed. And so we think of that moment when the rejected one is going to become the glorious one. And he will return in power and in great glory. And there's something within our hearts if we understand who Jesus is and we realize how deeply things are out of whack when he is not rightfully where he ought to be. From our heart that goes that statement, even so, come, Lord Jesus. And we recognize that God has given him a name which is above every name, and at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. I was not, it was interesting to hear Ron's story and Richard and Roy's and Colleen's story coming from different kind of contexts. My story is entirely different. My story is of being brought up in a Christian family in the third or fourth generation of those who'd come to know the Lord. And as a young boy, I can remember as a young boy, 7 years of age, sitting in church, and my grandfather, who died that year, sitting over there. I knew where he said he was one of the elders of the church. And I remember singing songs. I remember singing the hymns. All hail the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall. The highest place that heaven holds is his, and his alone. My grandfather died in at a later stage, as I said, when I was 7 years of age, so I didn't really know him, but I did know him in a in an extended way, but as I began to exercise gifts that God had given me as a teenager and begin to speak in different churches, inevitably people would come up to me and they would say, your grandfather would be so proud of you. You know, your grandfather, and they would always say this, your grandfather loved the truth that the Lord Jesus was coming back. He said, I don't remember him ever getting up, and we had an open service in the Christian Brethren style. He said, I never remember him ever getting up without talking about the coming of the Lord Jesus and the return of the Lord Jesus. One of the great things, even listening to Ron's story and to the Tinker story, is to know that if the Lord tarries, their children will be telling a story like my story. Amen. And celebrating God's faithfulness through the generations with this longing for the glory of our Lord Jesus to be revealed. Well, there's lots of other things in chapter seven, but I'd like you to turn to chapter 9 for just a moment. And saying to turn to chapter 9 for just a moment is a major challenge, because this is a great chapter. Challenging, but a marvelous chapter. Daniel was a man of the word, and he'd been studying Jeremiah, and he'd become convinced that the captivity in Jerusalem was going to last for 70 years. And he knew his calendar. And 70 years was just about up. This is now in verse 1, the first year of Darius. And the Persians have come. And it's 66, 67 years since he's been out of the land. And he knows how to count. And his heart's beginning to thump. And he's beginning to anticipate this. And yet at the same time, he also knows enough scripture to say that the only way in which Israel will be restored to the land is if they repent. That they were out of the land because of their sin, that they would not repent. And so he prays a prayer of repentance. And out of that prayer of repentance, God responds by sending his angel with a proclamation. As it says in verse 22, Gabriel is the angel again. I've now come to give you insight and understanding. At the beginning of your plea for mercy, a word went out, and I've come to tell it to you, for you're greatly loved. Therefore, consider the word and understand the vision. Now, I'm not going to try and unpack the vision, tempting as that is. It begins with an announcement that God has a program and he's going to put all of these things in, and it's a program related to your nation, and it's directly related to the 70 years that you've been in captivity. And although it's not said in this place, it is said in the last chapter of 2 Chronicles that the reason that they were going to be in captivity for 70 years is that for 70 sabbatical years, they had been disobedient to God. And they hadn't kept the sabbatical year, the seventh year. And so he now begins to talk about a program related again to the sabbatical year concept, that there's going to be a program, as it says, of 70 sevens that are decreed about your people, verse 24 I'm reading, and your holy city to finish transgression, to put an end to sin, to atone for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal both vision and prophet, and to anoint the most holy place. Know therefore and understand that from the going out of the word to restore and build Jerusalem to the coming of the anointed one, the prince, shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. I do not agree with the English Standard Version's rendering here. It is very much in a minority position. And it is 69 weeks until Messiah the Prince comes. But I'm not going to get into all the details of that. Well, I want you to notice here very specifically is the things that are talked about, putting an end to sin, atonement for wickedness, bringing in complete righteousness, everlasting righteousness, completing prophecy, and anointing the most holy place is directly related to the work of Christ. And so he's saying there's this program that God is initiating, and from the time of this decree, and Adventists have their own unique unraveling of this decree. I wish I had time to talk about the details of it. I am convinced it's the most remarkable prophecy, if you can have one prophecy more remarkable than another. I think the fulfillment of the prophecy brings us to the very week in which Jesus entered the city of Jerusalem, in what we call Palm Sunday, fulfilled to that day. But the phrase that is striking to me, and what I want to draw your attention to here, is what is said related to that. It says after, verse 26, after the 62 weeks, the anointed one shall be cut off and have nothing. The anointed one is, in Hebrew, Mashiach. Mashiach the prince will come, but he will be cut off and he will have nothing. It's interesting that that word cut off has about it the idea of cutting something off, but it also has the idea of being put to death. And the prophecy is a prophecy that this anointed one, the Messiah, the prince, somehow related to this kingdom that God is going to bring, is going to suffer an apparent devastating defeat. That he's going to be cut off and have nothing. It's the same word that's used in the book of Isaiah in chapter 53. By oppression, wickedness, who of our generation considered that he was cut off from the land of the living for the transgression of my people, to whom the stroke was due? I don't know whether Daniel knew the book of Isaiah as clearly as he knew the book of Jeremiah. I wonder if as he wrote that, he entered into the puzzlement of, he grew up before us like a plant out of dry ground. He had no stately form or majesty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. We hid, as it were, our faces from him. Surely he's borne our transgression and carried our sorrows, but we had no place for him. All we like sheep had gone astray, and we turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. I remember when I began to study Hebrew, and we had to do a paper in class, our presentation in class. And I remember I didn't know very much. It was probably the second year of it, and our professor had just come back from his doctorate, finishing his doctorate at Harvard, and he was no slouch in terms of, he drove us like crazy in terms of doing that. But I can remember I'd always puzzled over verse 10 of Isaiah 53. It says in the King James, it pleased the Lord to crush him, putting him to grief. If he would make a soul an offering sin, he would see his seed, he would prolong his days, and the good pleasure of the Lord would prosper his hand. And I remember taking out my Hebrew Bible and trying all it was to, I was going to solve this problem. And all I discovered was that there's a mystery there that I cannot begin to understand. That God the Father willed for his Son to be crushed, to bear my sin and my guilt. Messiah was cut off and apparently had nothing. When we get to chapter 12 of Daniel, we hear about the resurrection. First time the bodily resurrection is clearly taught in the Old Testament, but it isn't told us in chapter 9. We're just left with this amazing fact that Messiah, the Prince, the Son of Man, who has an everlasting kingdom and an everlasting dominion, was cut off. But he himself said, "No one takes my life from me. I lay it down on mine own initiative." The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I quoted Matthew 20:28 earlier. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. He never said, "I come to give you an example." He did give us an example. He left us an example. Peter says, "So we should follow in his steps," but the steps that we are to follow in is the steps of suffering. But then, even as Peter wrestles with having said he left an example that we should follow in his steps, he begins to quote Isaiah 53. Not that we can be redemptive like Christ, but this is how we know the love of God. He first loved us and gave his Son to be the full payment for our sins. So when we think about the mysteries of the putting together of the book of Daniel and all of these other things, it still presents us with the wonder beyond all wonders. That God loves us like this. He gave his Son. The wonders of wonders that his Son willingly laid down his life as the full and complete payment for our sins. And held the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Keep on doing this in remembrance of me." And so as we come to the end of this time and we've puzzled our way through different things and probably raised some questions that you didn't have when you came, hopefully put some things in order, what I want to make sure we do is we focus on the wonder that's at the very heart of all that God has done. That the sovereign God who moves all things by the word of his power sent his Son, and his Son freely consented to be the substitute in your place and in mine. He was cut off, and humanly speaking, he had nothing. But I love what Paul says. God made him to be sin for us, the one who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. That's our privilege, simply through faith and trust. God justifies the ungodly The good news here is every one of us qualifies. But God loves us with an everlasting love. And when Christ enters into his glory, we enter into it too. That's our hope, and that's our certainty. Well, we're going to conclude our time together as brothers and sisters in Christ, just partaking of the symbols that he gave us on the night that he was betrayed. And we come from different church backgrounds. We come from different kinds of contexts. And what we're going to do is pass the symbols, and they will be distributed. And then we will take them together after they've been distributed. The Lord Jesus, through the apostle, tells us to eat in remembrance of me. But he also, through the Holy Spirit, invites us to examine ourselves, not to see whether we're worthy, but to lay our unworthiness at his feet in repentance and receive the gift of forgiveness once again that keeps refreshing our heart and our soul. He's faithful. And we're going to celebrate in the new covenant the faithfulness of our God. I always like to think of the cup especially, as the sign of the new covenant. Just like Noah would look up at the sky and he would see the rainbow and he would remember that covenant, and just like as a Jewish male would look at his own body and he would see the mark of covenant on his body. So we now take these symbols as signs of the new covenant and of the promise that God has made to us in Christ. And we take them and give thanks. So remain seated so they can distribute the symbols. We're going to sing a couple of verses together. Jonathan leads us, and then I will lead us in taking the symbols together. And then we will sing again. And then Richard is going to come and lead us again, something else. Father, this piece of bread is such a small thing to symbolize such an immense thing. We know the grace of our Lord Jesus, that though he was rich, for our sakes he became his poor, that we through his poverty might be rich. As we take this bread, we think of the body that he not only assumed as he assumed full humanity, but the body that bore our sins on the cross. We hear him say, "This bread is my body given for you. Take, eat of it." And we do, and give you thanks, our God. And we remember, Lord Jesus, that you loved us and loosed us from our sins, washed us from our sins in your own blood. And we hear you saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is for the forgiveness of sins." And we drink of it and give you thanks. Amen.